This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. This is in the nature of a sort of prologue to this very unusual show. First, it's our first Dreamland video. It won't be the last one. We're going to be doing more video over time. Whenever we have a guest who has a good camera set up, we will do video. But what happened in this video, this is one of the most unusual shows I've ever done. It's a wonderful show with a man named Mark Sims, and you'll learn more about Mark in a few minutes. You will also learn about what he does with these radios, and then you will see after at the end of the show, we will add on a segment that shows what happens when I turn on one of these radios in this house. It was pretty unusual. So sit back and enjoy Dreamland. And for those of you who are listening only on audio, I held up a small radio called a Baofeng two-way radio that both sends and receives radio signals. So on with the show. Folks, welcome to Dreamland. We're talking today to one of the most interesting people I have met in a very long time. In fact, a member of a whole crew of interesting people. And what makes them interesting to us is that they have evolved a remarkable method of, is it contact? It seems to be. It's certainly very strange. We'll be talking about these radios in a few minutes in detail. I'm holding up, for those of you who are listening and not on video, I'm holding up a radio. It is a small portable radio, and it's called a Baofeng radio. You can get them on Amazon for between $50 and $90, depending on the model you get. And we'll be talking about how to set these up in such a way that they may begin to receive signals. Now, here's the reason. We think, oh, well, you know, signals, it could be anything, a radar, nearby radar installation or something sending out spurious signals. But, as Mark discovered, if you put these things in a Faraday cage, that is something that blocks out all radio frequency signals, these signals keep coming. All right, now that said, Mark Sims is a Harvard Business School graduate. He describes himself as a serial entrepreneur. Welcome to Dreamland, Mark. And can you tell us a little bit about your background, which is in itself quite a story?
Well, thank you, Whitley. It's a real pleasure to be on your program. Like you said, have started a number of businesses. My first company that I started in 1992 was an internet security company, and it was the first pure play internet security company that was ever established. I sold that business in 1999, retired for a few years, and then started my second company, which was a software company where I set out to develop a 3D modeling program specifically for the purpose of designing nanoscale machine systems and simulating them on the computer with the hope one day of being able to fabricate them. So people may have heard of nanobots or nanomachines. This was the goal of the software. My background, I should mention, is in computer-aided design. I have a Bachelor's of Science in Computer-Aided Design from Eastern Michigan University. I was hired out of school by Sun Microsystems, which was at the time, 1986, one of the leading engineering computing platforms. They made the Sun workstation, which was a very nice, low-cost favorite computer for doing 2D and 3D design. So I worked for Sun Microsystems from 1986 until 1992. And I left Sun to start my first company, Netrex. That's the internet security company. So my second business, Nanorex, where we designed and actually released a program called NanoEngineer One, was for the purpose of designing nanoscale machine systems in atomic resolution. And that meant creating a radically new kind of 3D modeling program where every atom was accounted for in the design, and that you could actually do nanomechanical simulations on the computer by attaching these virtual, what we call jigs, for creating torque or linear motion, springs. These were other types of mechanical objects that we would virtually attach to the assembly to simulate mechanical and electromechanical motion, it turns out. So that was in 2004 that I started that company, and I decided to put that company aside in 2009. I actually was visited by the CIA in 2008 because we had demonstrated the ability to design and then synthesize nanoscale systems out of DNA. In 2006, we began a collaboration with a group of scientists at Caltech that specialize in an area called structural DNA nanotechnology, where they use DNA as a mechanism to self-assemble nanoscale structures from the bottom up. They simply design single strands of DNA with specific nucleotide sequences in such a way that when they mix those strings together in solution, they will naturally self-assemble into these aggregate larger structures. And we felt that our software could benefit their research if we added support for modeling DNA and RNA to accelerate the designs that they could achieve. And we actually did that in collaboration. We showed that in less than a week, we went from a conceptual design to synthesis. And that then led to a visit from the CIA. We ended up getting their attention because it was clear that this was very advanced technology that had potentially national security implications, and I believe that was true. And so I decided it was the responsible thing to do to shut that company down until the ethical issues around using a software like this could be addressed. So then I retired. I took up ballroom dancing as a hobby, and I got through myself into that, and I actually became an amateur champion ballroom dancer. And it was at that time that my life changed. I had a face-to-face contact experience in 2012, and I'll get more into that. But before I get ahead of myself, I just wanted to give you some background, give your viewers some background about myself. So I'm a total geek, IT geek.
Yeah, we have that impression.
And I love technology and its potential for doing good for humanity.
You know, you're very much like some others who have been on this show. Deep Prasad, Gary Nolan, and a couple of others. Brilliant scientists who have open minds and strong ethics. And they end up in contact. And it's absolutely fascinating. I think if I took all of your profiles together, I would see that this was a very consistent aspect of it, was this ethical aspect. And I want to go back now to what you said about your contact with the CIA and your decision to to basically back off from that company and for ethical reasons. And can you tell us exactly what they were?
Yeah, well, what I was learning as I was developing the software and adding new capabilities to the software, I really didn't have a background in biology, in virology, or and I started studying viruses in particular because they represented the simplest life forms that we could model with our software. I was very interested in adding support for laying down peptide chains sequences of amino acids that fold into proteins, and the proteins are the building blocks of life. And so I recognized that this software, after having success with DNA modeling, if we expanded the modeling system to include proteins and then simulated the folding of proteins into their final structure, we could build libraries of these proteins and use them as building blocks to assemble aggregate structures. And viruses are very interesting, living organisms in that they're relatively simple. And one of the things that I was very surprised by was that there are many cases of viruses that have millions of proteins, but they're comprised of a very small set of them. So let's say 30 or 40 proteins are all the number different types of proteins you need to create a virus. They're just used many, many times. They kind of fit together or self-assemble into sphere-like structures, or the different organelles or parts of the virus, like the capsid, which is the main body that holds the DNA. So I began recognizing that what we were building was really a CAD system for designing synthetic viruses. That would be a natural pathway for what we were creating, and that was the thing that raised the flag. And it was when the CIA came to visit me, it was right at that time that I had made that connection. And the CIA doesn't come knocking on your door unless there's something really serious that they're interested in knowing about.
Yeah, that's for sure.
And so I really took that whole thing to heart. I felt obligated morally to put that software aside. I was developing it open source and funding the entire research and development out of my back pocket from the money I'd made from my first business. So it was really a passion I had, and it was a pure research project. And I had no business plan to make money with it. I had two goals with NanoEngineer One. The first was to bend the minds of young people into the sciences, primarily the nanoscale sciences, because I really felt that advanced nanotechnology could improve the human condition in profound ways, solving many of the world's problems. The second goal, which we ended up doing, it was an ambitious goal, which I really didn't anticipate accomplishing, but we did, and that was proving that we could go from a concept in software, a design in software, to fabrication of a nanoscale target structure with atomic resolution. And we did that in 2008. And that work was done by Paul Rodeman, Dr. Paul Rodeman at Caltech. He took the design that we developed at NanoRex, and it spit out all the nucleotide sequences for all the strands of DNA. I ordered the strands from a biology company that provides the service of creating DNA, and then sent it to the lab at Caltech, and he then did the one-pot reaction that he invented called DNA origami, where they mix in literally hundreds or thousands of strands of DNA together, and they self-assemble in solution. And then you take a drop of that solution after it's finished, put it on a slide, in effect, and then image it with an atomic force microscope. And we showed that we had succeeded in creating our target structure.
And interestingly enough, of all the people I met a week ago Saturday night on the show I was on with you, and can you remind me of the name of it? You know, I am, to be honest with you, I am on so many shows that it slipped my mind, but it was a wonderful show. You please talk about it a little bit.
Sure. The name of the show is Saturday Night Alive for the Global Peace Tribe. And it was started by a good friend of mine, Deborah Giusti, and her partner, business partner, Scott Katamas. And I had been on their program a number of times. They've now been on every Saturday night for the past year since the pandemic started. And they have wonderful guests on. They feature themes about peace and you're kind of opening the mind up to ways that we can improve the world.
Exactly the sort of things the visitors are interested in other words.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm in pretty much contact with them, and it's not like being sitting across a table from each other. But when I went to my 3 o'clock at 3 a.m. meditation, which I do every night, which is now the one where all of the useful information comes from, meaning that it's the one I can't miss. They never miss a trick, but in any case. And I thought about the show, and I wanted, and what you had been accomplishing with radios, and I wanted to talk to someone. The name Mark Sims came up immediately. I did not know anything about you at the time, but now that I know your background in the sciences, I understand why they were interested, that you are a highly accomplished but also very ethical scientist, and you call yourself on your website a spiritual scientist. Now, before we continue on, however, Free Dreamlanders, you're going to listen to these commercials, and if you're watching on video, what you're going to see is a thumbnail, and you'll hear the commercials underneath the thumbnail because we don't have video commercials. So enjoy them, and subscribers, of course, we will keep on just keeping right on.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place, and above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. Okay, Mark Sims's website is simple. It's marksims.com. and on it you will find a very interesting book available soon called 13 Days with, and excuse me if I'm not getting this name right, Jezdbar. Is that correct or correct me?
It's Tejbar.
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 All right. A cautionary tale of encountering a celestial being. Let's work into this carefully, and we're going to get to these radios pretty soon, because I think you can probably, we're probably going to make some changes in the way this is all, this whole contact thing is unfolding, because simply because the visitors told me from the beginning, the people are who they're interested in contacting. They're not interested in the disclosure project at all. They don't care. They do care about how they are made to appear. They care very much about that because they have objectives here for us. And some of those objectives are maybe not what we would like. Others are. And we'll have to work that out with them and with ourselves as time goes on. But the primary focus of their interest is each individual who's interested being able to organize a state of contact with them. As far as they're concerned, there are billions of potential points of contact on planet Earth. Every single living creature, and those of us who have intelligence, have the potential to have much more complex contact. Okay, so tell us about the book and why it is a cautionary tale.
Well, the book is about my experience of a face-to-face encounter with a light being, a celestial being, as I later learned, in the privacy of my hotel room. This took place in November of 2012 while I was attending a six-day retreat that had been organized by Dr. Stephen Greer. I had learned about Greer by watching the Disclosure Project, which was an event he organized in 2001, and he had about 20 military veterans and government officials who got before news cameras and gave their personal accounts while they were on active duty or working with the government of either encountering UFOs or having face-to-face encounters with extraterrestrials. I found their testimony very compelling. I found them very believable, and realized after watching the Disclosure Project that if what they were saying was true, even if just one of them were telling the truth, that this was the biggest story in human history, and I wanted to know more about it. So I began doing some research on Dr. Greer because he was just a civilian. He wasn't from the military or the government. He had organized this event himself. He was emceeing it. And I discovered that he had published 3 books. And so I bought them, I read them. And as a consequence, my skepticism was lowered to a point where I thought I would try going to one of his retreats where he would teach people a meditative practice that he called the CE5 protocol that he claimed could initiate contact with extraterrestrial intelligence. So I was retired at the time. I was doing my ballroom dancing thing. I had just won my first major championship and decided that I'd like to take a break and go to California. I lived in Michigan at the time. So I flew to San Diego, rented a car, and drove to Borrego Springs, California, which is about 2 hours northeast of San Diego, and that's where Greer organized this particular event. And there were about 25 of us that attended, and for 6 days, we would get together every evening about 8 o'clock in the desert, not far outside of Borrego Springs, about a quarter mile or a half mile out from the town. And we would gather in a circle and meditate for about an hour, hour and a half at a time for 2 times each evening. on the fifth evening of this six-day retreat, we are sitting there, and after our first meditation, we are looking in the sky, and right where I'm looking, an object materializes out of thin air, right where I'm looking. It was this beautiful egg-shaped object that was green, bluish green. It appeared like a geodesic dome, only it was elongated, more like an ellipsoid. But I recognized it right away as a geodesic ellipsoid because of my background in computer graphics. I'd actually written programs to render a geodesic sphere, which is a sphere made of triangles, made famous by Buckminster Fuller. He was the inventor of this design. He made the domes. So that was what I saw. And I saw it materialize out of thin air, and then it dematerialized just as quickly as it had materialized. And it was visible for no longer than 3 or 4 seconds at the most, but it was moving, it was very large. And as it was moving, I could see stars behind it. So I knew that it was never fully materialized, even though it was visible to me. And other people saw it. Not everyone saw it because it wasn't directly above us. It was to the east, northeast of where we were sitting, and I happened to be facing that direction. Other people in the circle who were facing towards me missed it because it was so brief of an encounter, but I would say about half of the group saw it. I happened to see it the entire time. Again, it was exactly in my line of sight, and I was focused on it and saw it come out of nothingness. And so when I saw that, it answered for me this burning question that I was there to answer, and that was, are we alone? Are they really here? And when I saw that, I knew that that was not a man-made object. That was otherworldly, and what's more is it had this divine nature to it. The quality of the light and the color was nothing like I had seen before. And I was really left with a sense of awe and of some heavenly, you know. And what's so surprising about these choice of words I'm giving you is that I was an atheist my entire adult life. I was a devout atheist. I had come to the conclusion that there was no God. It was all man-made, these belief systems in some deity. And so I really had come out and, you know, called myself an atheist all my entire adult life from the time I was in college. But when I saw that, something, I felt like I saw something of a divine nature. So that was the trigger for me. And we would stay out in the desert every evening until about 1 o'clock in the morning meditating, and then we would fold up our chairs and get in our cars and drive back to the hotel. So that night, when I went back to my hotel room, I got ready for bed, and I'm laying in bed, and I can't sleep, of course, because I'm so amped up.
Understandable.
Right? And, you know, I now have these follow-up questions. You know, who are they? Where are they from? What's their agenda? Why are they so reclusive and aloof? You know, it occurred to me that, you know, there might be a government cover-up. I want to know the truth. But now that I know that they're real, they clearly are hiding themselves from us for some reason. This isn't a government cover-up. This is an ET cover-up. You know,
exactly.
And so I wanted to know answers to these questions as I tossed and turned in bed. So after about a half hour of knowing there's no way I'm going to sleep, it occurred to me that maybe I should try this protocol that Greer had been teaching us in the privacy of my hotel room. Maybe there would be a chance that they're watching me and monitoring all of us who had seen this ship. It was such a major sighting. So I imagined that, yeah, they probably are monitoring us and seeing how we would react. And I wanted to reach out to them and say, I'm ready for a face-to-face experience. I'm not going to be afraid. I want to know the truth. And I don't believe that they're malevolent. I really believe that they are here for good reasons. And so I just made a commitment to myself that I wasn't going to freak out if something appeared in my hotel room. But that was the intention that I set as I began sitting up in my bed and meditating. So I took the lotus seated position at the head of my bed, closed my eyes, and began doing this three-syllable mantra that Greer had taught all of us. And after about a minute or two, maybe 3 minutes of doing this mantra, I noticed that there was this light blue swirling light, like a fog, that was growing in my vision, in my third eye. And this was swirling very slowly, and over the next few minutes, it began to get brighter and coalesce into a well-defined sphere in my mind's eye. And when that got really well-defined and bright, these rings of light, of again, light blue light, were coming into the sphere from outside of my peripheral vision. And that continued for about a minute. And then that stopped. And as soon as that stopped, this orb began to morph into a humanoid shape. And when it was finished morphing, it just was this humanoid standing in front of me, facing me. And I kept my eyes closed, waiting for something to happen, either for it to walk around in my mind's eye or to disappear. But it just was persistent. It just stood there. And it must have been 4 or 5 minutes as I sat there with my eyes closed looking at it that I decided to open my eyes. And when I opened my eyes, standing at the end of my bed was a light being, was a what was obviously a non-physical being made of light. And I could see through parts of its body. It was semi-transparent in its torso, for instance. The head was very bright and opaque, and it had eyes, round eyes, and a head that was very much like a human head. But what was very peculiar is that it had a what I thought was a crest, because it had a slope bilaterally that extended down from the top of its head. And that was unusual. It looked like a human that had a pointy head. But it was definitely not, it wasn't like a cone head, like the Saturday Night Live character.
I remember the cone heads very well.
But it was much more shallow. And so I noticed that. And then it had this very thin neck, rather long neck, sitting on very slight, skinny body, long arms, longer than human arms, with long fingers. I tried to count the fingers, but I couldn't, because there was a bit of a glow around the fingers and around the body. He was scintillating. There was this kind of sparkly, scintillating light quality to his glow. And so it made it hard to kind of make out details like his fingers. And he also had his fingers at his hands at his side. And from that perspective, I couldn't count the digits. Had a very small waist. And then these skinny legs that were then blocked by the end of the bed, so I couldn't see anything below his thigh level. So I had practiced a greeting. In the rare or unlikely event that I would have a visitor, I thought, well, if I have somebody who receives me, I would like to say something to them. What would I say? So I practiced a short greeting, and the greeting had three components.
First, Mark, we have to take a brief break for our free Dreamlanders, and when we come back, Mark will tell us those three components of this greeting and continue this marvelous story. We'll be right back. My new book, Jesus, A New Vision, is an entirely new vision of the life of Jesus and what happened after. Among many other things, it is about why the resurrection happened and what happened to the teaching of Jesus that led to the creation of Christianity. It's an extraordinary and virtually untold story. Graham Hancock, author of Fingerprints of the Gods, says, Whitley Strieber's take on Jesus is thought-provoking and inspiring. This is an important investigation filled with new insights, highly recommended. Toby Johnson, author of Finding Your Own True Myth, What I Learned from Joseph Campbell, says, "Very wise and satisfying for the contemporary mind. My book does not deny the divinity of Jesus, but it looks at the power of the human mind and the human soul in a whole new way." It's available as a Kindle, as a paperback, and as an audio book on Apple Books and on Amazon.com. Listen to this sample from the audio book. Reading the canonical Gospels with the eye of a detective reveals much that has been hidden, more or less in plain sight. For example, it is clear that Jesus intentionally goaded the Romans into killing him. I think that the reason that he did this is understandable, as I will discuss. He was also helped by a group of people who are almost invisible in the Gospels, but not quite. They must have been incredibly learned. In fact, they must have known and understood the secret of death itself, and thus how to surmount it. They were not members of any known order such as the Essenes. So who were they? And for that matter, as he was not a deity come to earth, who was he, really? Using a combination of a re-examination of his story and the application of scientific tools to, for example, study the Shroud of Turin, we can make exciting strides toward recovering the secrets that they must have known. Some of them are hidden in the Shroud, which it would now appear cannot have been a medieval forgery, as was incorrectly concluded back in 1988. As shall be seen, the evidence refuting that conclusion is strong. The implications of the resurrection event are amazing and exciting and have something very new to say not only about Jesus, but about us. Jesus, a New Vision. Get it today. 1968, Glynis Mackay is a desperate woman. She's been told she's dying of cancer. She can no longer speak. She receives a psychic communication from aliens that she has been in touch with for years. Listen to her talk about what happened.
I went into this huge room, and there were many other people sitting and some lying on couches that had come there for healing. And then he said to me, "You understand who sent you here to me?" And I'm thinking, what does he mean? And then he said, "You've been having communication for many, many years from who you call UFOs." And I thought, my God, how does he know this? And I'm trying to sort of push back on the chair, looking a bit shocked probably. And he said to me, "When you leave here at 10 past 12 today, there are two craft over the house and you will see them."
And she and her mother-in-law both saw a UFO hanging over their house. Subsequently, Glynis's cancer disappeared, and she went on to become one of the world's most extraordinary mediums. UnknownCountry.com and Dreamland are among the very few places Glynis has interviewed. She became close friends with Ann Strieber and with myself, and in our own personal lives revealed some extraordinary experiences. I had a contact with a dead friend so incredible with Glynis that it convinced me that there must be something more. There almost has to be. In fact, many things have taken me in that direction, but this was just shocking. In any case, you can hear all of this as a subscriber to UnknownCountry.com by going to our vast archive. It's so simple to search. Just look at the subject cloud on the left side after you enter the subscriber area, and you'll find so much there. Go to UnknownCountry.com right now and subscribe. It's an immensely valuable and deeply empowering archive, and the site needs your support.
Okay, Mark, we're back. Mark Sims's website is marksims.com. His book will be out.
when? Do you have any idea?
It was supposed to be out last June, but then the harmonic convergence happened, and I did not complete the book in time. And so it's now my new goal to have it done by June 14th of this year. And that's a realistic date. I will definitely have it done.
My grandson's birthday, I'm June 13th, and he's born on Harmonic Convergence Day. My new grandson. I've got three grandkids. Okay. Speaking of three, I'd just like to interject something briefly before we go on. And that is the manifestation of the object that was made up of triangles. This is very important because, as indeed Buckminster Fuller himself said, the triangle is the building block of the universe. It is the beginning of all spiritual search, and it is also the way atoms work. A proton and a neutron held together by the strong force. I think it's the strong force, but in any case, and in a human being, the emotions and the intelligence held together by the soul. And in the Sphinx, it's the courage of the lion, the strength of the bull, and the intelligence of the man. And when the three are in harmony, they spread their wings like an eagle and rise above the world into objective understanding of reality. So that's what you saw. That was a teaching. Now, let's talk about the three things.
Yeah, so there were three points in my greeting that I felt were important. And this was all decided before I began meditating and had my encounter. The first and most important thing is I wanted to show my appreciation. I wanted to say thank you. I'm deeply honored and grateful for you to come and see me. Second, that I wanted the intention be known that I desired a friendship, a relationship with this being, to learn from it. I had heard from Greer and other experiencers the previous 5 days there at the retreat that they claimed they had encountered and then become developed friendships or relationships with extraterrestrials from other star systems. And when I saw that ship, I knew they were real. And then I believed these people that they may indeed have had encounters and long-lasting friendships with these beings. So I wanted that. I wanted that intention to be known. And third and finally, I just wanted to show my trust in them, whoever showed up. I decided to say, I completely trust you to do with me and my body anything that you choose. I completely trust you. So that was my greeting, and I gave it telepathically, because Greer and many others said that you don't need to talk, they can hear your thoughts. So I projected this greeting, and as soon as I finished saying this greeting, it began slowly moving from the end of my bed and approaching me on the left side. And I maintained my composure, I just sat still, I watched it. But it was kind of freaky being approached by a light being for the first time.
It does tend to be freaky.
And my eyes are glued on his eyes. I'm just looking at his face. And as he's approaching me, he gets about a foot or foot and a half away. He's standing right next to me. And I'm looking at him just like this. And what I realize as I'm looking into his eyes is that his eyes are not eyes. They were literally sockets of a skull. I thought what were pupils when he was standing at the end of my bed, these slits, were actually the orbital canal that the optic nerve from the eyeball goes to the brain. And mistaking those orbits, you know, the sockets as orbits of the skull or eye sockets of the skull was unmistakable, because I could also see the fissures between the platelets that make up the socket. If you know anything about the skull anatomy, the eye socket is comprised of small platelets, bones, that come together and they form these little cracks or fissures. And I could see them because he was so close. And as I'm realizing what I'm seeing, I notice his hand is moving. And so I look down and he's got a finger and he's starting to come at my elbow with his index finger, and I'm letting him. I see he wants to touch me, so I'm going to allow him to touch me. And he ends up touching my elbow, and I feel this tingly sensation, like static electricity or pins.
Yeah, I know it well. Yes.
And so he holds his finger on my elbow for a moment, and then he continues to push his finger into my elbow. And I can feel the penetration, and it feels like this growing sensation of tingly, you know, static electricity as he's penetrating my elbow. And then I can feel his finger entering the left side of my torso. He's going through my back now, and he's continuing now to the right side of my torso. And as that's happening, now his right shoulder is beginning to overlap and merge with my left shoulder. And as soon as that happened, I started to freak out, because it was already freaky enough, but when his shoulder began merging with mine, that tingly sensation became very intense suddenly. And I almost jumped up, because my fight or flight response was kicking
in. Yes, it's very hard.
And it took every bit of my willpower to sit still, to force myself to sit and stay still and allow him to continue to enter my body.
So and glad was, you did. Go ahead.
Me too. Me too, because it was quite a ride. You know, it's like the biggest roller coaster going down that first hill. That's what it felt like. I was just like holding on for dear life to sit still and not freak out. And he completely submerged himself in my body. I was tingling all over. And then after about 30 seconds, maybe a little longer, I began noticing that tingly sensation was dissipating. It was beginning to weaken. And after another minute, it was only another minute or so, I felt normal again. That tingly sensation completely subsided. But then I was left with this acute awareness that there was another being inside of me. And I don't know how I knew it, but I knew it. There was no doubt. There is another entity inside of me, another
yes.
person, a being, a male, a masculine entity.
Yes, I live like that, so I know exactly what you're talking about. Go ahead. And oh, by the way, let me just say, folks, if you want to know more about this integrative living, read A New World. There's a lot about it in there. So, because it is contact. Oh, thanks, Mark. How sweet of you. Contact is integration. This is what it is. Go ahead, Mark.
Well, I just want to say, I believe your book, A New World, is the most important book ever written on this subject. You answer questions that people are naturally going to have about who they are and why would they want to make contact with us.
Yes.
And what is
and you
what,
had the experience.
I know. I've experienced it. I know what you say is true, and you've nailed it. You've articulated it so well. And my hat is off to you, Whitley, because it's complex. It's hard to put into words the emotions and the reasons and everything about this experience, what communion is about.
Right.
And so here I am in this state of communion, which I later learned. He told me this what I was experiencing was a communion experience. But before we got to that, you know, as I'm aware that there's this other entity inside of me, I decide finally to ask him a question. And that question was, what is your name? And using my vocal cords and my mouth, he said, Tejabar.
Oh, my.
And I said, Tejabar? And he said, no, Tejabar. And I said, spell it. And he said, T-E-Z-J-B-A-R, Tejbar. And so once he spelled it, I could enunciate it properly. And I began repeating his name over and over, and I could feel his satisfaction. It was a feeling. He was satisfied with the way I was articulating his name. And once I got that, I then asked him my second question, and that was, where are you from? And he said, I'm from Earth. Now, that wasn't the answer I was expecting.
No.
To say the least.
But it's the true answer.
It was the true answer, and yes. He explained it to me. You know, you've got to understand.
Remember the skull that you saw? You realized you were looking at a skull?
Yes.
That was communicating to you that he was dead in our life. In other words, he was from the other level of reality.
That's right. Ahead. That is exactly right. So, you know, I asked where he's from, and I was expecting to hear the typical answer that I'd been hearing from other people during this retreat that claim to have relationships with ETs from Zeta Reticuli, from Arcturus, from the Pleiades. Yes. I mean, that wasn't the answer I got. And so I was confused, and I told him, I said, you do not look like any Earth creature I've ever seen. Can you explain? And he said, yes, I was human once, roughly 3,000 years ago. And when I died, I ascended to the astral realm. I was a chieftain from an area that is today called Tierra del Fuego. You will find it in the southernmost tip of South America. Now, when he told me that, I had never heard of Tierra del Fuego. And so this came through so clearly that I wanted to confirm it, because it occurred to me that maybe I'm just talking to myself, because, you know, it is.
Yeah, that's always a question.
Talking to yourself. But the information I was just given, there's no way I could have told myself that. I'd never heard of Tierra del Fuego, and he was specific about where I'd find it. So I stopped my interview. I got my laptop computer that I had with me, and I had internet access and Wi-Fi in the hotel. So I started Google Earth, and I typed Tierra del Fuego. I hit the search button. And you know how the globe rotates and zooms in? And I could tell it was going right towards the southern tip of South America. And you could have knocked me over with a feather, because I was just blown away. I knew for sure that I was having a real experience, that this was not my imagination. I was having contact.
You were.
Absolutely, I was. And
this is the best description of contact as it really is, folks, that I've ever heard. Go ahead, Mark.
So I decided before I put my computer away that I ought to Google his name, because it was such an unusual spelling. I wasn't really expecting anything, but I decided to do it. So I typed Tejbar, and I got one hit on Google, on the Google library. This was back in 2012. And that link was to a Google Docs book that had been scanned. It was a book called The Tribes of Tierra del Fuego.
Oh my goodness.
It was written and published in 1916 by an anthropologist named Jonathan Cooper, who was given a grant by the Smithsonian to study the tribes of Tierra del Fuego. And in the book, there is a glossary of words that were translated from the Fuegian language. That's the name of the language that the tribes of Tierra del Fuego speak. It's Fuegian. There's a glossary of the common words that were translated into phonetic English. And there's a word in the glossary, Tejbar, T-E-Z-J-B-A-R, that translates into forehead. And so I took this as a second major confirmation that I was having a real experience. And I put away my computer, and I had brought with me a journal that I was keeping notes every day of my experience during the retreat. And I got my pen, and I began just taking notes of interviewing this being. And so my next question to him was to ask him about this place. He said he had ascended to the astral realm after his death as a human. And I said, this sounds like what the Christian concept of heaven is, the astral realm. Is that right? And he says, yes, it is what the Christians would consider heaven, but it's much more complex than that. And my next question is, well, is this where I'm going to go when I die? And he said, no, not necessarily. What typically happens when a human dies is that they're reincarnated to continue their journey of learning. But under certain conditions, if they are met, then you can ascend. And I asked him, well, what are those conditions for ascension? And he basically said, well, you're getting ahead of yourself. I'll come back to that. And so he kind of took the discussion another direction, and we began talking about about reincarnation. And so that ended up being all about how the human soul evolves to the human level of consciousness. And according to Tejbar, he explained that we begin individuated consciousness as animals in the animal kingdom. And so the most simple life forms, like those arthropods, insects and spiders and bugs, that's where individualized consciousness begins. And through the modus operandi of reincarnation, after an insect dies, it's reincarnated as another insect. And gradually that soul that develops what he calls the astral body, the immortal part of us, survives death, finds a host in the embryo or in the egg of a developing life form, gives birth, and continues its experience. And through this experience, it gains knowledge and instincts that are necessary for survival. And we go, according to Tejbar, through four major stages of conscious evolution in the animal kingdom before we reach human consciousness, what he called the human kingdom. And those four stages involved, in stage one, the arthropods primarily. Stage two is amphibians, reptiles, and fish. Stage three is birds. Stage four is mammals and marsupials. And then stage five is the human stage. And then he went on to share with me what it was like for him in stage six, stage seven, and these other stages of conscious evolution for the soul. But between stage five, the human stage, and stage six, there's this major ascension, this giving birth. He equated it to the caterpillar turning into the butterfly.
Exactly.
And becoming a new thing, giving birth to a new type of body. And that's what he went on to share with me.
That is exactly... That's very close to what I've understood myself. And I think that as life has gone on this planet, we have become gradually more and more, the souls have become more and more complex until now this immense burden of human life is here, because there are so many souls that have evolved on planet Earth, that are still needing to reincarnate, that are also capable of intelligent self-reflection. So we have a problem, the problem being that there are more of us than the planet can sustain.
That's
right. And all of the yelling and screaming about they're not doing it right, or they are, this is that, this is a simple fact. And it is also part of nature. Because when the planet fails, as it will, in a very intricate and very organized way, it's not going to be, it's going to look accidental, but it's not accidental. What's going to happen is the souls that need to evolve will find, still in physical bodies, will find a way. And those that can ascend will ascend. And it's called being born, and it's always terribly noisy and scary going down the birth canal, which is what we're doing now. Mark, I'm going to just keep the show going. Normally, our free Dreamlanders only get the first hour of the show, but we're just getting into the radios, and this is much too important, because this material, folks, is real about all of this, and I'm here to advance contact. That's my job. I don't, as you notice, I hardly ever talk about disclosure and so forth, because the government end of it isn't very important. This is what's important, what's happening here. Mark is a brilliant guy. He's strong. He has a strong ethical presence. He's, in other words, exactly a highly evolved scientific mind. He's exactly what the visitors need to advance this and to help us all. Mark doesn't seem like a teacher. He seems like a really nice guy, but then again, a lot of teachers are. So it's time for you to start teaching us about these things and how they work and why that works. Oh, good. So here we are, radio to radio. Okay. Now, walk me through it. And folks, those of you who are listening will be able to see pictures of these radios on the website. So don't worry about that. You'll be able to see. Okay.
So I'll take you through a really quick setup. These radios are made by a manufacturer in Korea called Baofeng, and they make a number of models with different power output capabilities and frequency ranges. But these are used primarily by ham radio enthusiasts or CB radio enthusiasts to talk, and they require a license to operate. But you can buy them from Amazon and you can operate them without a license, but it would be a good idea for you to at least get a GM or a General Mobile radio service license. They don't require any test or anything. You just have to pay a small fee with the FCC and you get your license, and then you can at least operate these at certain frequencies. So I'm going to take you through how to set the frequencies on these. This is a two-channel handheld two-way radio. It's an 8-watt radio, which is the most powerful handheld radio that I've found, and this is why I like this particular model. They make a 5-watt model as well, which is much less expensive, and it's very good. In fact, I've got one right here. They come in yellow and blue and red. They're basically the same, and they can be configured exactly the same. So when we turn it on, this is the knob to turn it on. You just turn it clockwise, and it will, the LED screen will turn on, and there are two numbers. These are the frequencies that are programmable for channel, what's called A and channel B. The top number is channel A, the bottom number is channel B, and this AB button, the blue button on the front, Whitley, if you press that, you'll notice a little triangle at the front of both of these numbers toggle between them. And yes, that indicates whether you're on channel A or channel B. It's really that simple. You also have this red button. There are two modes of operation, what's called channel mode and frequency mode. And in channel mode, this limits the frequencies that the radio will use to those in the what's called the family radio service or the general mobile radio service channels that are predetermined by the FCC for legal use. But if you change it to frequency mode, so that's channel mode,
frequency mode,
and that's frequency mode. So you'll hear the radio tell you what mode it's in. So again,
channel mode.
That's channel mode,
frequency mode,
and frequency mode. So you want to go to frequency mode, and then you can use the keyboard on the front to plug in or type in the frequency that you want to set the radio to. And I'm going to plug in the frequency 467.712, and so you just type that number in, the six digits of that number.
467.712.
Now that frequency is one of the channels, specifically channel 14 on the family radio service frequency. And so that's a legal frequency that anybody can use to broadcast a message. And now the question becomes, how do you broadcast a message? Well, on the side of this radio, there are three buttons. The middle button is the push to talk button. It says PTT, and that stands for push to talk. And while you hold that down, you are broadcasting whatever you say into the microphone. Or you could play a recording from your phone or from the computer. And what Jimmy Blanchette, my colleague and dear friend, who's...
we will have on Dreamland soon.
Good. Yeah, he's great. He's really the one to be credited with discovering this as a modality for contact. He's been an amateur radio operator since the age of 12 years old. He grew up in on a farm in northern Quebec, Canada, and he's built many radio antennas for extending two-way communication, operating ham radios. And in 2016, he developed something called the TARP antenna, which he developed for the purpose of participating in an exotic type of two-way communication called moon bounce communication. So it think of it as a laser for radio waves. You know, most radio antennas are designed to propagate radio waves laterally to cover as much surface area of the Earth as possible. But this antenna is designed to kind of as a laser pointer to point at an object. And by beaming radio waves at the moon, it can be used as a passive reflector, and the radio waves bounce back to Earth and can be received by another radio station on the other side of the Earth, as long as it has line of sight to the moon. And he has done this over 600 times with other radio operators around the world. And it's amazing that it can be done at all. But that's what he originally started doing in 2016. And then it occurred to him, you know, I have such a powerful device here. Why don't I try sending a message to EETs? If they're out there, they might be listening and they might respond. And to his surprise, they responded to him. And there's a famous case of another Canadian. His name was Wilbert Brockhouse Smith, and he worked for the Canadian government. He was a radio engineer, and he developed a way to initiate contact with radios as well. And he is the first case that I know of in which a radio station was used to initiate contact with extraterrestrials, and he ended up writing a book about it called The New Science. And in that book, he tells the story about encountering an ET, a pilot of a craft. That name was AFA, his name was AFA. And AFA shared with Wilbert Smith information about the nature of reality. And that's a book that I have read many times. And in fact, I want to get the permission of the family because it was never formally published. And I have recreated it, and I want to make it available because I think there's some really important information about the nature of these beings and of reality itself and the relationship of consciousness to reality that is very important for people to begin to understand regarding this phenomenon. So anyway, these radios, I believe the way that they're working is that they are propagating electromagnetic radiation in the form of radio waves in 3D space or in 4D space-time. But what we're not aware of is that it's also radiating energy in the higher realms, in the higher dimensions. And because of the way that Jimmy has encoded the messages into the transmissions, it's a special audio file in which he encodes a two-dimensional image into audio file. When he transmits it, it is easy for them to perceive and respond to. That's the key. He is he's found the way to unlock this radio as a communication device for initiating contact. And we have, over the last 7 or 8 months, Jimmy and I have engaged with other friends of ours to validate these experiments to show that this is repeatable, it works every time, and we have something to study. And it's very, very exciting.
Well, tell us how you transform the video, or the image rather, into a sound that you can then transmit by simply turning your phone on with the sound there and playing it into the, while holding down the transmit button.
Okay, well, I can actually demonstrate it, but before I do, I just want to share with you how we convert an image into a sound file. There's a special program called Photosounder that you can download. You buy it at photosounder.com. It allows you to load any arbitrary image, a JPEG or a PNG, into it, and then you can, you know, turn some parameters that determine what frequency range that image will be encoded into a sound file. And then the sound file can be saved on your computer and then played on any digital device, a phone, your computer, or a recorder, a digital recorder. And when it's played, you can actually use another piece of software called an audio analyzer or a spectro analyzer that can then decode the encoded message in the sound file. And that's what I'm going to demonstrate. And this is really where you can kind of put it together. So this is an app that I just started on my cell phone. It's called Spectrum View, all one word. And what you're seeing right now is my voice being plotted on the screen. So let me demonstrate. I can sing a note. These bands, these standing waves, are the frequencies that make up the note that I just sang. So the intensity of a particular frequency is plotted on this 2D graph as a color. And the brighter the color, the more intense that frequency. So now if we take, let's say, the audio message that Jimmy created, let me play this now, and I'm going to turn it sideways so you can see this in real time. Let me just, okay, we're ready to go. Watch this.
Folks, so those of you who are listening, what you're seeing, what we're seeing is the audio message, the visual of the audio that you're hearing is appearing on the screen. And Mark will explain what that is in just a minute.
So this is a message that was created in Photoshop and then converted into the audio file, and it's still plotting. I can pause it. And if you go to the website ce6.world, I have a detailed explanation of what this message is, and you can also play the audio file as well. There's a link to the audio file, and you can replay it on your computer. You can actually download it and play it on your phone. And this is the audio file that you want to broadcast when you're attempting to initiate contact. It's a great.
This audio file?
Well, it's encoded. It's got a special greeting with some imagery that we believe is significant and will have meaning to our visitors, our star family, as we call them, and that initiates a response from them.
So it frequently does initiate a response, is what you're saying.
That's right.
Now tell us about the response. How does that happen?
Well, what you do is you play this audio file over the radio, and then you set the radio down and just wait for a response. And the response is chatter. You know, it's not anything that's intelligible. It just sounds like weird static, but it's got an energy to it. And over time, you begin to feel what they're saying. It's just, you know, again, in communion style, the way they're communicating
yes.
isn't verbally, it's through energy, it's through feeling. And that is what happens. And the people who have done this experiment with Jimmy and me all experience that they are developing a relationship with the entity on the other side of that radio, whoever's communicating. We leave these radios on after making contact, and very often they'll interject. When we're having a conversation with a family member about something, they'll suddenly butt in and start chattering away, and you can get a sense that they're excited or they're just having, they want to say something. So what they're saying, it can't be defined in our terms, but I believe that this is a process, and maybe what is at hand here is they want this modality of contact to become popular, to go viral.
They
and
do.
As we interact with them through the radios, maybe they will share more and make it more obvious to us that they indeed can understand everything that we're saying and that they can communicate with us in ways that are very clear that this is an intelligence that's having a relationship with us.
We are in a situation where we have a great deal of difficulty communicating with pure mental contact because our minds and imaginations get in the way. And this is why we have so much confusion about who and what they are and where they're from and so on and so forth. And what this process over the next few years will be is a process of focusing and making things more clear. And one of the ways that will work is this, that because as you mentioned, when you transmit something with this, it goes out into the radio spectrum, but it also goes out into a larger spectrum. Now, you can synchronize yourself with this by doing what I call the sensing exercise, which you may not know about, Mark, because what it does is it amplifies the vibrations of the nervous system. You probably do know about it if you've read my books.
That's right.
Right, of course. I'm sorry. But in any case, if you do that while you are in communication, especially when they begin to communicate back with you, you will begin to get more and more clarity. But it's terribly, terribly important not to let your own mind tell you things that you've heard from someone else that aren't part of it. It's a matter of being open, and it is going to be hard. It's not easy, because the mind wants to connect the dots. And, you know, my wife was truly a master, and she used to say to me again and again, Whitley, don't connect the dots. The human species is too young to have beliefs. What we need are good questions. So that's a very fundamental reality here. A lot of people can do, anyone can do this. I mean, you can get these radios used, I'm sure, on eBay probably, work perfectly well. And you can do this. Now tell us about what happens when you are receiving a communication and you put the radio into a Faraday cage. for those of you who don't know what a Faraday cage is, folks, it's a cage that, it's not a cage actually. They now look like more like envelopes. Or a microwave oven is a perfect example of one. Inside there, no radio signals can reach. And in the case of microwaves, they're that way so that no microwaves can get out. But also, when the door of a microwave is closed, nothing can get in either. So what happens?
Yeah, so I did an experiment recently where I got a bunch of Faraday bags, and after establishing communication with the radio, using the radio, I took the antenna off, primarily so that I could fit it in the first bag. But I wanted to also show that the signals come so strong into the radio that you don't need the antenna anymore. And so I took the antenna off, then I put the radio in 7 nested Faraday bags. And I picked 7 because I had previously done a quick experiment just to see how many Faraday bags it would take to make it so that if I transmitted this radio, which is 8 watts, to another radio right next to them, you really need a thick bag, because this is putting out 8 watts of power. So I put one of the radios that was receiving messages in there. You could still hear the transmissions being received on the radio. And then I tried to showed that if I press the transmit button on the radio outside of the bag, that message could not be received by the bag or the radio inside the bag. And then I took it out of the 7th bag, so the radio was still going off with 6 bags. And then you could tell I was making communication with the radio inside. So that's just something to be aware of. I mean, if you put a standard FM radio inside a microwave oven or in just one Faraday bag, it wouldn't receive any transmissions because the radio wave strength is relatively low. The transmitter is very far away. But with my experiments, these radios are very powerful, and them being right next to each other, it required a lot of bags to completely isolate the test radio.
And you did isolate that, so therefore, and the signals continued to come through. Now, you mentioned before that there's an energetic component to these signals. They're not radio signals. They're only picked up by a radio. Something is happening that we don't really fully understand. Is that correct?
Absolutely. I have a personal theory about how they're interacting with the radios, and it's certainly not with radio waves, because the other radios would receive the transmission simultaneously, and that's not what we observe. But to best understand, I'd like to use an illustration. I have drawn an illustration in which I have I have 3 beings. These are 2-dimensional beings, and I've represented their eyes and their different shapes. And they've built a 2-dimensional radio here in an effort to initiate contact with higher dimensional intelligence, that being us, because we're 3-dimensional. We can observe them without their awareness, because we're in a 3rd dimension that they cannot perceive or experience. But when they transmit a message with their 2-dimensional radio, they see the radio waves propagating from the transmitter, from the antenna, radially. But what they're not aware of is that this radio transmission is propagating perpendicular to the 2-dimensional flat world in which they are living. And we, being 3-dimensional beings, could have a radio sitting next to us, or we could just maybe even hear it because our bodies are very sensitive to the fluctuations of the electromagnetic spectrum. And when we feel that radiation, maybe we interpret it in a way like our eyes interpret photons, and we can actually see the message. And that's what my theory is that these higher dimensional beings are in effect of frequency and vibration. And so when they receive an electromagnetic energy, like the ones sent or broadcast from these radios, they literally see the message that's encoded in the radio.
I think that's probably correct. And, we're going to take this as far as we can. And as our planet becomes more and more restless and cranky, it's very cranky right now with all these terrible storms all over the world, goodness knows, it's going to get crankier. We're going to begin to really search the skies. And there's something the visitors told me about back in the 80s or early 90s is about searching the skies, and they said a number of things. One, many human beings will go insane, and that's happening. Two, that there will be an effort to search the skies. And I just had Avi Loeb on Dreamland a couple of weeks ago. He is the Harvard astronomer who claims that Oumuamua probably was an alien artifact. That's searching the skies, and there are scientists searching for Dyson spheres around stars in an effort to find alien presences. And it's very important that they do this, because that level of the mind needs to know that there is life, intelligent life specifically, out there. Even if it does not accept what you're doing, at least it knows it's there. But the chances of physically moving between planets with a body like this are not great. But once you're in the second body, out of this body, everything changes. Right. So that's where we are. And tell us a little bit about the message that is on that site, and repeat the name of the site again, if you will.
It's ce6.world, and ce6
world
dot world, and it is an attempt, well, I should say the ce6 category is something that I personally coined as global human initiated contact. Argument could be made that it would fall under the CE5 moniker by definition, but I think that global synchronized contact is so important that it deserves its own category. And so I created this website to promote a citizens diplomacy initiative for initiating contact with our visitors, with our family.
Yes, and, because this is exactly what's wanted. This is the correct aim.
And so I'm attempting to organize events in which we can together use the radios and meditate in an effort to initiate contact. And I believe if we get enough people doing this together, that we can give them the permission slip that they need to show themselves to us, because they're not going to do it unless we're prepared. They would freak us out unless...
That's right. They won't unless you're prepared. Listen, I have had them very close to me, and when I felt the least bit of fear, they literally started withdrawing as if it was pushing them away, which is exactly what was happening. Fear right. pushes them away.
It does.
There's still a large contingent of people who are very negative about this. This is an example of one. This is an author who wants me to interview her because she is furious about this, what she regards as an intrusion. And there is, understanding this very clearly, I will interview her about on my show, because this is a show for everybody at every level. And there is a level of people, and a large number of people, who are not ready to function in this. And they either will ignore it, or be frightened of it, or put it off into various ominous folklores, and so on and so forth. And yet it isn't all sweetness and light. It can get very heavy duty. Very heavy duty if you're not careful. And I learned not a long time ago, but after 2015, after Annie passed away, that the key to good contact is the way you live. Not I see you smiling, you're reacting to that. Can you tell me what your impression of that is?
Yeah, you're right on. The bottom line is, be happy, be optimistic. Life is a miracle. You are a miracle. We yes. take for granted the fact that we're alive. Tejbar, when he communed with me, I felt it, and he said it directly. You do not know how good you have it, being a physical being.
Yeah,
says this beautiful planet, and you have something very special here. Don't blow it.
The visitor said very few things to me in this level of hearing. One of them was have joy. And as soon as I told that to Anne, she seized on it, and she said, that's it. That's the key. And how do you do that? I mean, it doesn't matter. It's not getting, she used to say, well, joy is not about getting a new TV. That's happiness. You've wanted a TV for a long time. Now you have it. Joy comes when someone puts a baby in your arms and that baby looks up at you and you look down at that baby. You have joy then. And that's the difference. And she used to say, remember Meister Eckhart, God laughs and plays. And, It was so much of that for man. And we have a very simple protocol for living in a way that will make this experience work for you. It is by living out of love, compassion, and humility. And if you really can do that, and I always got stuck on compassion. What is it? You know, is it giving a beggar a quarter, or I guess a dollar nowadays, or what is being compassionate? I asked Anne after she died what to tell me about compassion the way I could understand, and she said immediately, each one of us is all we have. And when you think that, and you're looking at a person you despise, or you don't like, or you think is wrong, and you see their struggle immediately, you understand, you accept, and you find your place in their struggle. This is not only between us, but between us and the higher levels of reality too.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, you've got lots of plans. There's no question about that. Tell us what's next. What about organizing this project around the CE6.world website? What is the What is the plan?
Well, the plan is to recruit other people like you that have a following and are interested or passionate in making contact. And just setting up events, initially once a month, maybe more often, to have people engaging in CE5 contact together, and doing this globally, and doing it in real time. And I believe that Zoom is a game changer for this kind of thing. Ultimately,
yes.
We could do this together in real time via Zoom, and people who are actually seeing something in the sky in response to our attempt to initiate contact, people see things in the sky, And my hope is that they can capture them on video and share them and stream them with
which you have done.
I have done.
And Jimmy has done it. Right.
That's
both of you. Now, what do you say to a problem like this? I have a very iffy relationship with Dr. Greer, and he with me, as far as I can tell. Now, it's iffy for a lot of reasons. One of them was that back in the 90s, he attacked me on Coast to Coast AM for some reason, which I never understood. But what do you do when it's obvious that the two of us have somehow got to come together? How do we do that? Because, you know, the visitors are demanding it. It's got to happen that way.
Well, I totally understand your question. I myself had any interaction with Greer other than I went to two of his retreats, but I never reached out to him, and I've never spoken to him personally about my experience, even though I credit him with, you know, my awakening and this amazing relationship that, you know, is all a consequence of being a part of his retreat. So I credit him for starting the CE5 movement. But I think, you know, Greer's an interesting person. He's very strong. He's got a strong personality. And
yes, true.
He wants to be in control. And I think that maybe it's because of his personality that this originally was able to happen. You know, it really took somebody with a personality like his to, like, damn the torpedoes, not be intimidated by threats or what have you,
right,
and go do this at a time when nobody was doing it and everybody thought it was crazy.
Right, and to do it regardless of the consequences.
That's right. And so he deserves a lot of credit for that.
But I find that
he's not a very good team player. That's my personal opinion. And many people, you're not the first, have echoed that sentiment. And so I think, you know, there's so many other people who are willing to work together as a team. And there's no ego in this. It's all about just helping others have their first contact experience and recognize the potential for how this could change the world for the better. Because once we make contact globally, the whole game is different. It's a whole different show. And I think it's the thing holding us back. It is the root cause of our existential dilemma right now. We got to break out of this prison that is the ego, the belief that we are at the apex of intelligence in the universe and that we're the only life in the universe. It's just not true at all.
And my way or the highway, not true either.
That's right.
Well, okay, so, good. I'm glad you clarified that, because everyone involved in this has a right, a completely fundamental right to participate as fully as they can. And someone with a difficult personality, it doesn't matter. They still have that right. And so I just wanted to make it clear that I recognize that very clearly, and I think you do too. Mark, we have come to the end of our time together. We've been together an hour and a half, and that's the usual length of Dreamland. And so, listeners, we're getting ready to sign off. But before we do that, I would advise you to go to ce6.world and look it over. Go to marksims.com and look it over. You can learn about the radios, and you will be able to contact Mark with your questions. I'll make sure that's possible. And we will move forward, because it's the time. It's time to move forward in terms of contact. Always remembering to, if you wish to do this successfully, do what Mark did in the moment that the entity began to enter him. He left his ego aside and let it happen. That's communion. Leaving your ego aside and letting it happen. So, onward, down the road. Extraordinary interview. Thank you so much for being with us, Mark Sims.
My pleasure. Thank you, Whitley.
I would also like to say to the free Dreamlanders who are listening to this, please subscribe. I don't have much money. I'm not totally broke, but I'm always close to the edge because 70,000 or something people listen to this show and only about 1,000 people subscribe. Now, that's ridiculously low compared to other sites that have subscribers because I don't know why, but it has to end. You got to do this. Make a tiny financial commitment to this, and maybe, just maybe, we will continue to go on.
Oh my goodness, Whitley, that is remarkable. You've made contact without even sending out the broadcast.
It says yes.
That is it.
Unfortunately, I don't have a.
I want to do something real quick. Can you hold the speaker up to your microphone? I want to record this. I want to.
Do it again.
See these bands, these light bands? Okay, now here I want you to do this. There are arrow buttons on the keypad. Can you see? Oh, I'm sorry. See these arrow buttons?
Yes.
I want you to press the up arrow once. This is great. Okay, what you just did is you changed the frequency by just 0.25 hertz, I believe. So you've switched to a different frequency. Now if you hit the down button, it'll take you back to 144.1. Now hit the down arrow again. Yeah, this is so cool. Whitley, you've done it. I'm blown away that you have made contact without even broadcasting the message. They are with you. They're with me
all the time. The visitors live here in this. They're, you know, the last time I was involved with them was during my 1 p.m. meditation an hour and a half ago.
So change it back to hit the up arrow. Wow.
Now, why isn't that just normal static? Would this continue if it was in a Faraday cage?
It will continue. Put it in your microwave. That will continue.
Okay, I'm going to do that. I'm going to put it in my microwave as soon as I get off the air, and I'll tell the listeners what happened.
Okay, and I have 144.1, and nothing's happening to mine right now.
Nothing's happening to yours. Isn't that extraordinary?
Yeah.
Well, this is a busy house. I knew that for a long time. Annie's involved. You can see her back there. She's... what a wonderful world we live in.
You made my day. Not only the interview made my day, but what we just did, this is confirmation for me. You do not appreciate, because you don't know the whole deal with the frequencies but
I don't know the technology very well, no.
I do, and what just happened is a miracle. It's absolutely confirmation to me that they want this.
That's correct. They told me I told you earlier.
I know,
they
but
told me they wanted this, and they told me you were the one I was to go to of all the people who were on that show on Saturday Night Alive together. And by the way, there's another person on that show that was very interesting to them called Adam Apollo. And
right.
He's going to be, I'm going to get him on Dreamland soon. So,
oh, great.
Yeah, I haven't talked to him yet, but I will. In any case, and the whole thing, it was a Saturday Night Alive's contact show, folks. And this is all going to be cut into this existing Dreamland. We're just going to go a little long, but that doesn't matter. I think everybody will listen. So, this can happen. And let me see. I'm just so fascinated.
And Whitley, I've seen it envisioned what's going to happen, and it's happened twice in a lucid dream where we're doing this CE6 contact work together, and they appear in the sky as points of light in a grid pattern that looks like a triangular grid pattern, like these domes right here.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. Above the earth, from horizon to horizon, they show up, and they just appear initially for a few minutes to make it unmistakable to everyone who's looking up in the sky that they're there, and then they go away, leaving us with the realization for the first time that we're not alone, and now we have a dialogue. It initiates a global dialogue about who are they, why, you know, what was this phenomenon that it's so great.
It's concentrating energy in my body. It's hard to turn it off. I'm really enjoying this, I have to tell you.
Can't you feel it? Can't you feel that's excitement?
I can feel it very clearly. I'm doing the sensing exercise now of moving my attention in part into my nervous system. And this is extraordinary, Mark.
Truly. Truly.
Thank you again. And folks, we're going down the road together.
Yes,
communion is at hand.
All right, Whitley.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.